taking security management concepts to SCADA environment. The eminent panelists with us will delve deep into different aspects of security management concepts for SCADA, like SCADA security testing, configuration management, monitoring, incident management in SCADA environment. So I'd like to call upon stage the moderator of this session, Mr. Subramania Boda, Group CISO GMR Group, Mr. Salim Javed, Technical Director, Asia Skybox Security, Dr. Rahul Rastogi, Senior Manager, EIL, Dr. Situ Sudarshan, Group Manager, ABB Corporate Research, Dr. Debu Nayak, Chief Information Security Officer, Huawei. So, Vanessa, I'll request you to take it forward.
Good morning. First, a small disclaimer. Whatever I say are purely my personal opinion, nothing to do with my official or my current or previous employers. Okay? And it's a really tough job for a panelist, especially in this panel. But my colleagues have assured me utmost comfort, because the three doctorates in InfoSec are sitting here. You would not get this kind of panel anywhere else on the earth. Okay, you'll probably walk away with some good stuff out of this, right? And Dr. Rahul Rastogi is heading the IT at the Engineers India Limited. Engineers India Limited is one of the premier PSU working on large infrastructure and large projects with the tons of industrial control systems in it. And Dr. Situ Subramanian is heading the research at the ABB. ABB is one of the fantastic name in transportation, industrial controls, and power generation, and tons of other things, of course. Dr. Debu, a long friend, and been in the information security industry for long, and he's one of the very few doctorates in the early stages of InfoSec, and probably the first in India, if I remember it right. And he's in the Huawei, dealing with the ICT and control systems in that area. ICT is like telecom, is one of the major users of and Salim is from a company which is called Skybox, and does some fantastic work in the area of vulnerability, patch management, and cybersecurity. Right? Perfect. First and foremost, I just want a quick audience poll. How many are related or working in the SCADA area, or SCADA security? Okay, that's a good fair amount. So I just want to ask, Situ, this is a question for you. What is the SCADA? And why should people be concerned about it? And people talk about SCADA and security. That also you can briefly cover.
So good morning, and thanks for the nice words, Subramanian. Okay, we are looking at SCADA is essentially a supervisory control and data acquisition system, for those who are not aware of the expansion, because we have just too many acronyms today, and everything has got multiple expansions. Coming back to the reality, SCADA systems are meant for any industry or any plant where a bunch of sensors are there, which need to be process information, or any environmental information needs to be sensed, and the sensed information needs to be processed at a higher level, and a decision has to be made for the actuator to work on. That has been the traditional way of working at it, or looking at SCADA systems. However, nowadays, thanks to the convergence, the way IT has become part and parcel of integrated networks of enterprises, also the smart plants and the SCADA system. At a higher level, we call it DCS, distributed control systems. They are all into one integrated seamless network from the top layer perspective. However, they perform totally different functions and the priorities are different. This also means suddenly we are looking at two kinds of traffic merging into one single road. It is like suddenly introducing trams onto a highway. or bullock carts becoming part and parcel of the highway. So how do you manage this sudden change in the ecosystem? What is the effect of the high-speed traffic on the bullock carts? Which, when I may say that, there are protocols like Modbus, which hardly run at serial communication speed, less than 20 kilobits per second, running alongside your gigabit Ethernet, that is traffic that is running the standard TCP/IP. So what is the effect of such a high-speed traffic co-located with a very low rate? It's like a deafening noise for it. So how it survives? The second thing is these small things are new pieces for the existing IT security systems, IDS, you know, firewalls and all. They don't know what this information is all about. So that is the second aspect. Put together, we are in a situation where the vulnerabilities of the IT systems are now extending to the SCADA systems, but the SCADA systems were initially designed to work in isolation in a closed environment with complete physical access control and only technically capable people handling it. But the fact that now it has suddenly opened the doors, if you recall yesterday, their point was about, if I have a door, I don't leave the house without locking it. And even if I have three doors, one for the garage, one for the walk-in, one for the service or from the top floor, I keep every door closed except the one that I need. But here suddenly, the moment it is integrated, such control is lost, at least in the IT OT integration that has happened. So that is the reason we have it. And this has actually resulted in a number of incidents. Not willingly, it is just because of sudden opening up of the policy, what happened in Russia when they opened up, or India when we opened up from the licensing regime to open, and that suddenly there are new issues that has come. And that is related to security as well as the availability. Of course, availability, some people make it part of security, but availability is a very important thing for industrial system, because if the system is not available, our infrastructure is down. Right. So that is the reason security of SCADA system today is a very, very number one issue, I would say.
That's a good question.
I'd just like to add.
Yeah, please.
Apart, even from, even if we take the integration aspect away from SCADA, integration with enterprise systems, today what we see is that SCADA is actually an IT system. So you have these sensors, and at the lowest level it is probably something which is still instrumentation based, but all the layers above that, it is very much an IT system. So you will, in any SCADA, you will find that database servers, web servers, firewalls, operating systems, applications are all a part of the typical SCADA system. And then, since everything is communicating, you have these protocols which come into the picture with their own vulnerabilities and issues.
So just to hold the mic close to them.
Right. So I would say that SCADA is an IT system. And that is where its problems begin, and that is where they have to be tackled.
So in a way, what you're saying is a SCADA system is becoming an IT system, and hence, can we apply the traditional IT security management principles to manage a SCADA security system? Can you delve into that?
Yeah, as we were discussing in the morning, there are substantial differences between a SCADA and a typical IT system. Not from the threats and vulnerabilities point of view, but from the perspective of the impacts and the nature of the beast itself. For example, typically what literature says is that in SCADA, availability is very important. Of course, we do not want a SCADA system to go down and cause problems with the underlying physical process. And there may be a risk to life. Whereas in a normal IT system, in an enterprise IT system, the risk to life may not be there. Of course, there may be a loss in terms of revenues, but definitely, or very likely, not a loss to life. So these two worlds are very different. The concerns are very different. The teams are very different. Their knowledge and competence is very different.
Right. Okay. Salim, she's talked about there is some risk to life. There is some risk to availability is a critical thing. Have you come across any such incidents which has impacted the world at large in a way that has leveraging some vulnerability in SCADA? Can you give some examples?
Yes. So as Sidhu was mentioning, Modbus is a perfect example of vulnerabilities which exist in SCADA. Which is, if you traditionally look into the SCADA environment, it's more focused on availability, which means like it is a network which is designed to run in real time. So security was not a key component which was considered. So if you look at the Modbus protocol, there is not enough encryption or authentication which is required. So if there is a threat actor who knows exactly how to modify a specific register, he could modify anything. So this is exactly where the cyber world comes to the physical world. And this SCADA systems actually acts as a bridge of cyber and physical. And this could be like destructive. So like very recently there has been an incident in a German steel plant where a cyber attack ended up, this was the first time it costed lives. There were like close to 4 or 5 people who lost their lives because there was a modification which was done. And this directly relates to the integrity of the data which is being controlled. So availability is required for SCADA, but integrity is another key component where the system might be doing what it's supposed to do, but end of the day, it only understands ones and zeros. And if that ones and zeros are modified, then there is always a threat to life.
Okay. Debu sir, if he's talking about risks to lives with a SCADA system, a DCS system, how does one prevent such a thing as a system itself, like you as a developer, a system developer, how do you take such steps to prevent such things?
Good morning. Before going to this, I just want to take another view that when I got my PhD, the announcement took place that he got the PhD in security and now he became doctor. I went to IIT and we have felicitated. And then Madam Pratibha Patil was giving best thesis award to me. Then my wife got angry. For 30 minutes you are getting an award in a security. So it took me 30 minutes to convince her, not the security where I am getting an award. And it took, my kid was at that time three years old, it took me almost 2 days to convince him that I am not the doctor where he is going and taking the injections. So that was the situation I faced in home, and I was so happy that we have developed such a beautiful community now, and we are talking to a specialized area like SCADA security. Forget about the generalized areas. We are talking now the specialized areas. So now let's come to the technology part. If you see the equipments that we are covering, all these parts, those who are dealing in the traditional ways, that has been retrofitted to various equipments. We have to understand that will not work in the power system. So what exactly all these IT equipments are controlling in the power system? They are controlling voltage, they are controlling current, they are controlling the phase angle, they are controlling the parameters which are different. And the control of these parameters that depends on the system that we create in the IT system, that will take care of all these parameters as inputs. You take any SCADA system, you go to the, open the box and make an audit, you will find out all the authentication systems that has been inbuilt in MD5, which is Berkeley University students have broken the MD5 algorithms long years back. So that is the basic system. When I send a signal that goes and authenticates and comes back and give me the permission, the moment I go this, then I find out a lot of things. If those are things are placed, then how can I improve these things? So the cryptographic means which has been embedded in all the systems in SCADA, that need to be improved. So this is one area actually when we develop the products for the SCADA environments, we have taken this as a various things. So you take the example of that Stuxnet. There actually where the SCADA discussions has happened. How it has happened these things? In the Siemens system, you will find out the Stuxnet had been found out, there is an antivirus company who find out these things, and he find out there is a rootkit has been there which has been installed remotely, and the rootkit is going to all the databases and getting the files, and in the files they are reading all the parameters, how the control of that can be changed. So those kind of information, how they got it? If your database is not hidden, that means the equipment what we are providing nowadays, you need to have a basic hygiene mechanism inbuilt in this. What are the hygienic mechanism? Like you have a basic thing is your operating system, basic thing is your middleware, and the on top of that you have the all these databases. If you hadn't those things, taking the industrial or any international standards, there are a lot of standards you can see. There are CIS standards, Center for Information Security, they provide the standards. We do take care of all these standards because I have been contributing the standards lot. So if you hadn't those standards, then you can embed the basic hygienic in the equipment. So that will kill 90% of your pain points. Rest of the advanced attacks, that can be taken care if you inbuilt some of the advanced mechanism like intelligence gathering and all these and anomaly detection inside these systems. So those can be incorporated in style by. So the next topic is how actually we do the testing, what are the testing tools in the SCADA system you can use. So all these factors I will come in the next.
You're talking about hardening the system. This seems to be a pretty common information security principle. How does one go about hardening a DCS? Can you, Dr. Subbu, can you please talk?
So the, some of the points raised, if I can quickly put phrases to it. Essentially, a SCADA system becomes a cyber physical system, which means anything on cyberspace can actually affect the physical systems. That is one. Even the driverless Google car met with an accident, it's another example of how things could actually come out in real life. So what if a drone actually bombs a wrong place? Those are kind of questions. But the second aspect that was raised was about availability. Essentially, we are now having a network where there is a priority inversion. In IT, it is initially we start with CIA, confidentiality. Pretty much from banking perspective, from finance, from military. So it's all about confidentiality. And then if it is confidential, then you worry about integrity. Then we say availability. So if a bank is not available for 3 hours a day, we say it is for your security, we want to maintain the system, we will agree. When it comes to the other system, it is exactly reverse. I cannot say we will shut down the power plant for 3 hours a day, you won't have electricity every day, 3 hours guaranteed power cut, so that we ensure you know it is secure. It's just not acceptable. Then we are talking about shutting down pretty much every system. And if you look at critical infrastructures that are defined globally by different countries, India has 17 such sectors, from defense, from power sector, to transportation, to all of them. So we need all of them to be available 24/7/365.25, whatever days it is. So that is where we are. And if it is available, then we are talking about, he took about the power system. So what about the flexibility? Is it 220 volts without any variation? Is it stable? Is the power factor appropriate? Is it clean? No ripples? Those are the questions. So with that priority inversion, the design of security solutions, because when we are integrating, I can say that majority of SCADA systems really do not have the security except for the air gap. The moment you close the air gap, the only security that is available by default is the IT security that is in place, which is designed not for availability, but for confidentiality. So the existing security mechanism itself will ensure that if there is something going on, first thing is you know, it will shut down. Basically, we are launching a denial of service on ourselves. Okay, that is the biggest challenge we are looking at. The second aspect we have is the systems of industrial systems, they have a really, really long life. If you look at a power plant, idle plant that were designed in 60s, they are still operational. The equipments are not changed because they are working fine and we have trained the manpower who can operate them. So 40 years down the line, it is still functioning and it is supplying to the grid electricity today also. If you want to change for the sake of security, the first question is, do we have the resources to do it? Both financial, second one is manpower. Two aspects to it. When it comes to finance, probably at the very top layer, we have GAIL, IOCL, or Power Grid and all, or NTPC, NHPC. They might be able to manage because they are at least into the Navaratna and above categories. They have some money to put in as a seed money. But what about the last mile? We are looking at electricity boards. where the lineman is at the most an ITA trained technician, and he knows only to, you know, switch on or switch off. He has a lever to operate or a relay to just pull it to one side or put it to the right position. Suddenly you are talking about digitizing everything and, you know, making it TCP/IP enabled and working on an IT system. So this migration is going to be the current challenge that we are facing. So the aspect one, most of the new systems that are coming in, like Dr. Debo pointed out, now the standards are evolving, where security is becoming part and parcel of the industrial control protocols. However, whatever is in field, they continue to operate with the old system. So essentially, if you take the same Modbus, which is a serial bus protocol, it is available on TCP, it is called the TCP Modbus. So it is nothing but clear plain text protocol, all register values predefined, that was also pointed by Salim. So which essentially means anybody, I don't need any big thing, all I need is one packet capturing tool, and everything is, you know, seen to me, it's like a glass house. And it is operational, and I cannot change it overnight. The second aspect is, if we, newer plants can have the new systems, but they have to coexist with the existing system. So the upgradation is happening in a very, very, at a very slow pace, and the upgradation is mostly more mandated rather than, you know, from willful willingness to spend and accommodate. It is like, I know there are risks, but I live. Pretty much like what happened in Chennai. I know it is a river bank, it's a lake, but you know, that is where I get borewell at a shorter distance. So when flood comes, we'll see anyway, we don't get rains often. So we have the situation today. Exactly a similar situation is today in our system, where the heritage systems are running. We know it has to be migrated. It's a known problem, but it's a challenge. So the baby step that is being taken are partly driven by the solution providers. For example, when recently XP was said, you know, no more support, that means suddenly there was a necessity for many systems to migrate and upgrade. So that was an opportunity where, you know, a lot of vendors, you know, not just ABB, the whole ecosystem took an initiative to upgrade a little bit. So it is more due to obsolescence and out of by force that we are migrating rather than willingness. At least in India, that is, you can say it is mainly cost driven, and second thing is manpower availability driven. These are two things. So probably that is one place we have to change the policy, saying that, you know, don't subsidize electricity boards for loss just blindly. Instead, upgrade the systems so that you don't have to worry about loss, because your efficiency improvement is so much, we don't have to deal with the loss of energy because it can be smartly controlled. It will also enable a smart digital India. So probably that is one area we have to work on. Second thing is, the new standards are emerging, but there is no consensus between the operators, developers, and the policymakers on when to make it mandatory. Emergence of standard alone does not ensure that it is implemented.
We could discuss, yes, about the new standards maybe slightly, sure, towards the later part. Dr. Rastogi, would you like to add, yeah, to the part of OT-IT convergence?
Right. So, as Dr. Sudarshan was mentioning, I mean, just to carry his analogy forward and to summarize, so we are in a context, we are in a context where everything is running very fast, is becoming smarter and smarter, and communication and IT is getting converged into everything. While at the same time, we have these old legacy systems, the bullock carts, so to say, which are also existing on that highway. So how do we carry everything forward without getting into the into a situation where we have disruptions, large-scale, massive disruptions? So the issue really is that we have a lack of knowledge at the moment, a lack of resources, while at the same time the system is becoming more fragile and it has got more vulnerabilities, and the system cannot be touched, because touching the system can lead to so many other problems. Downtime could be a big issue. So I think in that kind of context, innovators like Skybox, you have where you look at vulnerability assessment, and as you were saying that you do some kind of simulation, so that becomes so much more important. If you would like to add something.
Yeah, I was about to
quickly, yeah, before getting, I want to, he talked about downtime. Just I want to highlight, this may be something many of you may not be aware. We have customers in some of the process industries and power generation systems where the downtime has to be planned 3 years in advance and we have to inform the regulator that in 2017, on June 22nd, from this time, we are going to upgrade the system bit down. So think about planning for an upgrade 2-3 years in advance, assuming that I will have the solution as a provider, operator has the resources to upgrade, and hopefully the downtime is exactly as planned and it comes back to life on time and there are no hiccups. And in between we assume that the other ecosystem does not change, which is not in our control. That is a key thing. So probably know that, just to tell how complex it is in terms of even just planning a downtime.
Now the typical IT system downtime is at the drop of a hat, right?
In any case, we can start up very fast.
Yes, it's a startup is very fast.
Startup is very fast.
Right. Salim, please address the point where existing systems and integrating, how does one figure out what is going wrong with them and how do we go about fixing it?
So we are more, so everything which I have been hearing is all about managing risks. So which comes back to something which has always been used in the IT industry, more from the banking industry, which is like how to effectively manage risks. So when you look at that, it is more about understanding what you already have, so which is all about the legacy systems and the existing systems. So understand what you have, and once you have this information, it's all about who would come after this. So Dr. Naik was talking about Stuxnet. So what happened with Stuxnet was Stuxnet as a worm was not the direct impact. It was when US announced that they did it, all of a sudden everybody decided, okay, fine, it is acceptable, so I could go after from a strategic point of view. So right now, your threat actor all of a sudden become just wider, which is like it's not just hackers, it's just not script kiddies. There could be any kind of a state-sponsored attack. So what do you do against a state-sponsored attack? So these are different kind of threats which exist. So how do you effectively manage, which is first is understanding what you already have. So these are the different kind of components which you have, where your critical systems are, where your corporate systems are residing, how it is connected, where is your air gap, if you have an air gap, and what is now understanding your attack surface, which is which attack path will an attacker use to access my HMI, which is human machine interface. Now the moment that is done, it's game over. So how effectively you can use, so this is where you have the different kind of defense in depth, the IT specific controls which you already have, the perimeter protection, there is also the, when it comes to having access from the human machine interface to the corporate network, how do you control it? It's all about controlling, because that is always a great incentive when you have these data from data historian running different kind of big data analysis, which is what everybody is moving towards now. But how do you control this access? And there are also other options such as like data diodes, which is like widely used, but not everybody is aware of it. So how this can be efficiently placed, where it could be placed, and is it actually working for you or against you? Now this kind of an understanding and analysis has to happen constantly. And one big problem with OT is these are systems which have to be constantly available. So the biggest problem is you cannot go in and assess them immediately. So that is exactly where Rahul was talking about, how you could simulate different kind of attacks with your existing infrastructure. So which is all about understanding and modeling your existing infrastructure and understanding your attack surface. Once you have this information, then you could effectively manage risks, if not avoid it.
See, the notion of air gap, I don't feel it is appropriate in terms of power system. If you currently see, most of the power system are industrial WLAN has been employed in almost everywhere. I do not want to take the name of the advanced country where they have all this industrial WLAN system have been there, because you cannot go to a distribution area to collect the data and then you have to analyze, because there is a lot of problem happens. Sometimes in India, still we are collecting this data manually. But that advanced country where actually all these industrial WLAN systems have been placed, what exactly they have done, they have put the same WLAN security features in the industrial WLAN systems. So what is that algorithm is WEP, which has been broken long year back, has been incorporated there. So they are also put the TKIP algorithms, which has you can capture that packet, you analyze, I have a simple PC, I can analyze, and I can find out what are the various keys, then I can transmit. One of the hacker is a student, the same country, he went there, he captured all this data, and he shows how actually he can manipulate and change that power system data for almost 13 hours. He got all this information. So my take is, what I am going to say, okay, we can complement this kind of things. Can I run my Nessus and Nmap tools to build the industrial systems and put it there? Of course not. So there are tools which will be used for industrial control systems which are completely different. So normally when we do the threat and vulnerability analysis, we normally run this Nessus and Nmap tools and create all this port mapping and all this, and then we find out this will be appropriate. But there are those who will be interested, I can share a lot of tools which is actually specialized for industrial power control system, for the various oil and gas systems, where actually you can create your threat profiles and you can see how these tools can help you to make your system robust.
Maybe when we are talking about the testing that part, we can ask that question on the tools which you recommend, okay? Dr. Rastogi, he's talking about applying the same principles and practices do not exactly go well. But what should be done differently at the time of designing a new power plant or a new system, an industrial control system? What should be done? How does information security to be addressed or cyber security to be addressed in that?
Okay. See, the issues of cyber security in a SCADA are quite similar to what you would find in any other network, while at the same time they are very different also. So, and as the developing standards show, the concept of network segmentation is very important. So it's very important that we, when we are conceiving the design of a SCADA network, the network as such, when we are conceiving that design should be properly segmented. And the zones and conduits principles, that has to be properly implemented so that the problems in one part of the network do not travel to the other part of the network, and what is more secure is kept isolated from what is less secure. So that zoning is very important. So that would be the first principle, that segmentation, network segmentation, or the isolation of internet connectivity, the principles of DMZs, they should be, from an architectural or a topological standpoint, they should be conceived from the very start. Then, of course, we should have a program of managing the design and the implementation. So, I mean, it may be relevant to this. What I feel is that, the management, the discussion, the topic of our discussion today, the management can actually be seen as some kind of control loop over the process of, designing, implementing, and operating information security. So you have to look at, you have to have a 360 degree view of what is going to happen. So today, what we find is that when we talk about SCADA security, we feel that it is sufficient to talk about a firewall or maybe the use of an OPC server when we interconnect to an enterprise system. But we've got to go deeper. We've got to start looking at how antivirus will come into play, how application whitelisting will come into play, how vulnerability assessments and overall security assessments will come into play. So those are all the issues that need to be addressed.
Perfect. Devu sir, can you come back to that point? He talked from the as a system integration perspective. Now, as a DCS, how do you go about ensuring security? Like, how do you test? How do you put in, assure a customer on what is going on with your security?
Yeah.
And the same question I would follow it up with you, you need to address from the perspective of post-release, a product is released. How do you continue to assure is
See, that I have been repeatedly telling, security is a very intensive process, and testing is also a very intensive process. So we have our in-house testing labs. So this in-house testing lab has a security experts. They are not the basic security graduates. They are experts. They have been having the experience of minimum experience of 10 to 12 years. So they test all these products and they find out what are the various kinds of layer that tests. So of course, TCP, IP, all these protocols, inherently these kind of protocols will be there, and these threat profiles, whatever is existing, that will migrate. But when we design the firewall mechanism and inbuilt in the system, we create a blacklist and whitelist. The existing all this threat, what is happening, already we have filtered based on and put in the system. So that kind of testing mechanism should have required a lot of expertise to build into the system. So that is one part. The second part is the tool we are using. We do not download any tool and test our system. We have a very systematic approaches. We have spent $1 million to acquire these tools. Also, we have in-housely developed a lot of tools. What we feel, the tool itself can inject a lot of things that later will create a problems. So we have anybody cannot download any tool and start testing all these things. So we have placed a particular mechanism where actually this tool which has been tested, and these are first make sure these tools are secure. Then when we test based on these tools, make your product secure. So we give a lot of comfort levels to our customers saying that, look, these tools will be used and they are secure. We give a demo, we took them into the lab and we saw them in the naked eye how actually this has been happening. And then we show our products, we open up our box and show line by line how actually we are doing the testing. So based on this, you create all this confidence level to your. But having said that, I do not agree anybody is saying we are providing a 100% foolproof system. Being a security professional, if I'm admitting that, I think the biggest mistake I am making that. So what, after that, how can I support to my customers? So what, we build a product security incidents response team. That team is a huge team that is situated in one of our areas. So those team, the PSOC, which has extensive knowledge on the products, any incidents that is going to happen in the product, they proactively engage to the customers and they told, hey, look at, within 24, this is just going to be happen in our product that has been employed. So we go to the customers and tell, look at, these are the anomalies started happening in your equipments, and this is something that going to happen in 24 hours. We notify them 24 hours. We have the mechanism, within 15 days we fix all these things. So we keep on engaging from the day one to them so that their confidence level will increase. So that way actually we have number of steps where we follow, and that gives a lot of confidence building to the particular customers.
Sudarshan,
we
need
to
address.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. So Debo spoke about what they are doing in terms of development. Exactly similar, every organization at ABB as well, I'm sure you know it is true with our compatible partners as well. We are, while developing a thing itself, we have two parts. One is the product itself from its functional perspective, which are the protocols that need to be supported, only they are put. There is no universal thing, everything is no inbuilt. The idea is keep only those doors open that need access to that services that are needed. Today, if you look at it, just the TCP and UDP together, we have 65 plus 65, about 130,000 protocol ports that could be opened. Typically, what we find, or what I have found, rather than my own experience, rather than putting it on our organization, is rarely ports are controlled. That is the first biggest trouble. So what we do while developing a product is, from while shipping from ABB, we make sure two things we do. One is only those ports are open for which services are needed. And then we actually tell our customer, these are the only ports that are used by my product. However, they can cooperate, coexist, managed by a server which has other services to be run. or they may have other products that need different ports to be opened. But if they are opening, we recommend them to keep a track of exactly which ports are opening. That is very important, because if there is a vulnerability reported, there is no point in panicking without knowing whether it is going to affect me or not. If that port is not open to me, okay, it is more on a watch list rather than, you know, into the action list. So that is one aspect we definitely tell. Second, because there is a regulatory compliance and there is a liability that gets passed on, backed up. So if something goes wrong, if it is purely operational, definitely the operator has to take care. But even there, you know, with every product, we give guidelines. How to remain in compliance? Because, you know, at the time of installation, it is pretty much agreed upon with the customer. It is in compliance, then only it is, you know, accepted. But post that, how do they run the show? That is with them. But definitely there are cases where it comes back to us. And when it comes back to us saying that, hey, this product, this protocol or this service, you had this issue reported, and it is not in our hand, you have to fix in your product. So we have a mechanism by which every customer engages with us. We have a group cyber security portal which is available to any customer and the public also. Anybody can report. Because like Debu said, there are academics who are always testing and looking for vulnerabilities. People are doing research. There are, you know, hackers or, you know, ethical hackers who actually report it back saying that, hey, I found this. If you don't fix, I'm going to put it in public database and embarrass you. So there are very good people who actually come back. So we do take this feedback, immediately start acting. So again, not everything we control, because ABB depends on some of the protocol that come from our suppliers. For example, TCP/IP stack, I don't make. It comes from a third party. The operating system comes from another vendor. So if there is an issue that is underlying or fundamental, then what happens is then we go back to our supplier saying that, hey, your product, this protocol has this implementation issue because of which these many services are affected. That we have come because it is one incident has come. Probably that supplier has supplied to 5 different vendors who are supplying to 100 different end customers. So it is going to spread like left and right. So they have to fix. And here is where we have a big challenge, because you know there are multiple layers. How quickly we propagate it back? It is as good as yesterday's talk about, do we complain to police? Similarly, customer won't come to you saying that, you know, there is a problem with me, because everybody tries to contain the incident and try to manage in-house. Only when it is out of hand, it comes to you. And a similar thing happens, it goes back to us. Just I'll take one more minute. So that is one. The other aspect what we do is, we talked about tools. What we do is, more than the application perspective, the implementation itself of the protocol, because standard says RFP defines a protocol. Are we implementing as is, or is there a violation? 99% of time I can tell with confidence, we cannot implement as is because protocol says X. Your implementation language, let us say you write in C. C does not support exact, let us say, the buffer length. So now my defined buffer length is either 3 bits more or 6 bits more, which means there is a provision. Now I have to take care so that either the nobody can write to those 6 bits, I have to disable it, or alternately, I am keeping it open for somebody else to play around. That means there is a theoretical chance to misuse that buffer length. So we do something called protocol analysis. So robustness of the protocol, at least are we complying with the RFP as is? Because security is not based on the protocol, it is a plain text protocol. Obviously I cannot have encryption, but at least am I complying to exactly thing? Can you modify the register? Is it a legal value, illegal value? That much validation we can do. That is actually done in-house for everything.
If anybody have question, we have a mic which is in the center of the stage as the auditor at the hall. Please, a couple of things. Please identify yourself.
Yeah, I'm Aditya Samag. I'm part of the Marsh India Insurance Brokers Company. Actually, my question is related to what we have kind of witnessed in the last couple of days in terms of all the presentations. One of the themes that has come out is that the information security threats, the criminal space in that area is highly organized. So my credit card, you know, so there are cartels who are, you know, behind getting my credit card details, and not mine, I mean everybody else's. So the criminal space is highly organized there. When it comes to the information security space, not SCADA related. But now if you have to talk about the SCADA related, you know, the criminal space, is it highly organized? What kind of motivation is kind of there? And how vulnerable are we in terms of the, you know, criminals, you know, that kind of.
I think here you can give a
view. So if you can give us some examples of if something has really happened in this area.
Yes, I was talking about it, which is when you look at the threat actors, there are a lot of hackers, script kiddies, but the biggest problem is right now a state-sponsored attack, which is when it comes to SCADA and industrial control systems, if industrial espionage or any kind of a state-sponsored attack is targeting you, then that is something which is even more organized than anything else, because they have unlimited resources and they have unlimited time at their hands, and they are well sponsored. So yes, the threat is real when it comes to SCADA, because you do not know what your attack surface is going to be and who is going to come after you, and there is a bigger chance that it could actually be state-sponsored attack, and Stuxnet is an example for that.
Just to add there, it need not be, see, in most countries these kind of systems are the production control or industrial control systems are predominantly state-owned. In developed and underdevelopment countries, it is moving towards a more private-owned. So it can happen. Because this is a critical infrastructure of a nation, sometimes a state fighting state, someone can got in between. This is another risk which is unexpected, right? And probably a state getting caught, another state, but you are a friendly state, you can get caught. The permutations and combinations are enormous.
Just adding on to it, in addition to the state sponsored one, the IT-OT integration is very critical, because today if you look at it, the stock exchanges, that is based on how my company is going to perform. So if somebody can get an insider information, I can play around with stocks. So just think about it, the grid becoming smart, which is part and parcel of the enterprise or the internet, digital network, suddenly the demand supply, which the grid guys used to control for load balancing, that was totally limited to the grid system, suddenly is open because it is on the network. That means without insider support, which was needed earlier, say earlier if somebody has to know what is the demand supply, you have to call up, or somebody has to, who is inside has to give information. But today with integration, I don't need any insider support. If I am capable enough, I can actually figure out what is the demand supply right now. So I can actually start predicting, okay, looking at this demand, so and so particular company is going to be getting more demands, so I can play around with the stocks, because the demand is going up, going down. So it's not only state sponsored, slowly it is becoming a financial incentive also to be able to play around. So that's another critical aspect we need to keep in mind. Just wanted to add.
Just one more thing, if you consider the total the security space of SCADA, the incidents I think can cover the entire spectrum from a simple nuisance. For example, there is this PC in a SCADA network which will keep rebooting or restarting. So that's the nuisance. It doesn't cause any difficulty in the operation of the SCADA, but at the same time it is a bit of a nuisance.
Okay,
the other end of the spectrum is
can
that there is a widespread disruption in the SCADA, which actually translates into a disruption of the physical process, and the impact could be really substantial. So at the low end of the spectrum, where you are looking at a nuisance, probably the attacker could be something like a script kiddie, maybe somebody who's just ransomware. Or at the other end of the spectrum, where you're looking at large-scale disruption, it could be state-sponsored. Because unless, if you look at the Stuxnet incident, unless we have very detailed information, you cannot cause that kind of damage. And that kind of detailed information is not easily available.
So so specifically, there are four groups. After this discussion, you please contact me directly. I will give the name of those four groups, especially specialized for power system and they are the group are constantly working on these parts, and later you can monitor them and get a lot of information. I can give a lot of details on that four groups.
So that was the answer to the question asked by one of my fellow colleagues. Okay, I think we've heard the esteemed panel here on the critical infrastructure, SCADA systems. I got a slightly off-tangent question, and I would request Mr. Subramaniam, you and Dr. Rastogi, and they would do for you to kind of probably share your views on my question. What do you think is a realistic outlook in the Indian parlance towards SCADA security or critical infrastructure security as a boardroom agenda for cyber security? Is it really in talks, or is it really gaining the momentum? So I would probably have request, and Mr. Subramaniam, you manage GMR as a part of large group, airports and energy, and then private sector player in the SCADA, and of course Dr. Rastogi, EIL being a pioneer, talking to a number of things, and of course you coming from the perspective of being a system integrator. So my question is, what is really the realistic outlook of board? What is the level of attention they have towards security of critical infrastructure, and so to roll up into the cyber security?
Rastogi, you can start. And
sorry, I didn't introduce myself. My name is Rahul Gupta. I'm with KPMG.
I think it's a very important question, because I'll address this question very, very briefly and then hand it over to you. Do we need it? Do we need the boardroom kind of attention to this issue? Yes. Do we have it? Probably not. My understanding is that we do not probably at the moment have that kind of attention which this serious issue merits. And not even at the boardroom. Today it might appear from this discussion that SCADA is more about power systems and kind of distant from an individual. It is there in the background somewhere. But if you start looking at smart cities and all the things that are going to happen, and smart grids, and the way Internet of Things technologies are going to come, smart cars, GPS, all of those things are going to happen, smart meters at home, SCADA is going to be very up close and personal. And we as individual citizens have to ask not only the big corporations but even the legislatures to start looking at these issues.
Okay. You want to add a part to the question?
Shall we hear the panel first?
Yeah.
If that's okay.
Yeah. Okay. Firstly, okay, my disclaimer prevents me from revealing anything internal. Okay. Next. I will tell you what I have seen from my peers and my colleagues and in general. Okay. As we talked about the SCADA security, the SCADA is not the number one item on anybody's agenda. What is our number one agenda for any board is predominantly revenue and profitability and competitive, ability to stay ahead of the competition. That's simple. Right. Does the cyber security of, whether it is info security or cyber security, does it enable any of those three parameters? Then it becomes a board agenda. If it doesn't, it is possibly may not require the board agenda. It depends on industry to industry, area to area, company to company, risk ability to, from heavy, to someone taking a heavy risk to a moderate risk, it's a level of acceptance of risk. So this is number one. Number two, as such, the kind of exposure for these kind of the cyber security as a board agenda, our media is doing a fantastic job. Trust me, they've been writing articles after articles in the likes of Economic Times and so on, is already bringing that set of awareness. So it is helping a CISO like me or my peers a lot. Number one, first and foremost, in 2014, World Bank survey identified cybersecurity as one of the top 10 risks to be considered for any organization or any enterprise, they said. And that is definitely hit a point. It struck the chord with some of the board members. What is the cybersecurity? People started asking questions, right? Number one. Number two, now how are we impacted by the cybersecurity? That is when things like, yes, we are impacted by cybersecurity from the SCADA systems, from the IT systems, our revenue facing systems, our customer facing systems.
whatever. That's if it is related to revenue, profitability, and sustainability, and competition, or staying ahead of competition, certainly it's a bottom agenda. Nothing more.
Can I add?
Sure.
So, if you see the National Critical Infrastructure Protection Center that has been developed by Government of India, we have a now National Cyber Security Coordinator Center, and we have also appointed Dr. Gulshan Rai, and he is heading this, and smart city security requirements they are driving now. So it is, of course, government has started taking a lot of steps. So we blind cannot say ki nothing is happening. There are a lot of things they are started working on this. And if you want to contribute, you can also contribute. They are coming with smart city security guidelines. So we have also given our inputs. If you want, you can also give them. So industry is driving this. So a lot of efforts in the government are started taking this critical infrastructure protection. The moment this center will percolate to different kind of sub areas, whether it's oil and gas, power, telecom, so they will identify 6-7 critical areas, and there they are finding all these steps, and that will be taken care. So is it the government has taken adequate step? Yes, they have taken, and they are serious, and Prime Minister has rightly told, cyber security is integral part of my national security. And why it is justified? He has appointed a person who is highly qualified and is driving it. India has taken a lot of stand on this.
Just to quickly to add on to that, like Subramania pointed out, board agenda comes only if it is an issue that affects company's reputation, profitability, and things like that. So that is where, you know, today social media news, everything is doing a great job. But on top of it, good or bad, some incidents are actually becoming so public. Suddenly there is a bunch of activity that was unplanned starts happening, which is actually rolling out things. Two things I can quickly cite. One is the corporate social responsibility incentives. So a lot of people are now claiming to be green buildings, clean buildings, and you know, things like that. When they do that, you are actually introducing renewables and new systems. The fact that you are introducing new system means you are getting the latest equipment with the latest standards as part of it. So without worrying about heritage system, these newer systems are more or less, you know, at par with the industry state of the art or industry best. So that is one good thing. Even though CSR doesn't look like anything related to security, I personally believe that becoming a green energy is, and renewable is actually driving it indirectly. The second incident, for example, is what happened with the UP grid blackout. Even though there were a lot of political lashings at the back end, quite a bit of activity is happening in the background. And definitely there are, you know, task forces constituted at the top level, at the national level, and EIBB is also part of some of the things. There we are seriously working on how this can be taken care of, because as our national grid gets integrated with all the four regional grids and then further down to local subgrids, this is going to become, the blackout may not be today only UP, it could be all over the country. So that has actually awakened them up. Now there is a big activity going on. How it is going to roll out? Will it be a public policy document, or will it be some amendment which will be just rolled out? That is a question. But activities are happening, and it is a big agenda where, you know, huge public sector organizations like, you know, EAL, PGA, Power Grid, GAIL, then ABB, and there are several other players also, end operators, and the policy makers are sitting together and working on it. So I wanted to just highlight these two. So things are happening.
Last two questions, please.
Sure. Thanks. Thank you.
Yeah. Something is doing it right, sir. It's Ashwin. I work for PwC. My question is something related. As we all said that it's important critical infrastructure. Two questions is, we as security professionals, how do we address this to make it more more manageable? And related to this is, like we have ISMS for IT, right? Are we adopting ISMS or something, CSMS for the OT side of it, as at the company level, at the management level?
Yeah, thank you, Ashwin. This is a nice thing. We wanted to cover it, but you know, there was a shortage of time, we could not get into it. Quickly speaking, IT-OT integration means all the IT protocols, or you know, TCP/IP, all the layer 2 to 7 will continue to remain. But what the current IT system doesn't address is industrial control protocols, which are running on the same TCP/IP infrastructure, same Ethernet layer protocol, but they have their own mechanism. They don't rely on TCP/IP. There are plenty of layer 2 protocols, for example, Fieldbus and all. So the IT industry is not even aware of such protocol, if I can make it, you know, in a very critical way. So the moment they are aware, I'm pretty sure we have brilliant minds which can come up with, you know, a larger, more intelligent solution which can consider the entire traffic on the wire. True. Rather than I only address protocol XYZ.
Absolutely.
Because tomorrow, n number of protocols are going to keep on evolving. It could be proprietary, it could be encrypted. The question is, can I consider each and every bit and take care of the security as a whole, holistic view?
Yeah.
So one is the awareness of industrial control protocol. Two, even education system. I have interviewed a number of MTech in network communication. They can talk about TCP/IP, little bit UDP. Anything beyond, they say, HTTP, yes, what is this DNT3, what is this else? So they are not even aware.
True.
And we are calling them master in the MTech in network communication, and they are not even aware of the protocol. So how can they even design security, I don't know, take care of it? That is one aspect. So we need to increase the awareness of the ICP along with standard network protocols. It should become integrated into the curriculum. So that is what I would like to answer.
So what I was telling you is not going at a low level. I'm going at it's even higher level, at layer 3 of the network and everything, like when we have switches, routers. In my experience, I've seen that we don't even have SIM solutions in many large OT networks. We don't know our traffic, and we don't even monitor the traffic at level 3 and level 3.5. Forget the level 4 and above, or even lower. So such things are important, and we need to have management of cybersecurity of OT and more IT/OT integrated environments, more of a holistic view than just the technical view.
Yes, I think it cannot be denied that a management system is required. You need an ISMS for managing the security or the cybersecurity of SCADA. It's an absolute imperative. It cannot be denied.
Just that. See, ISMS, we need to understand, ISMS system does not say that it is for only IT security. It says that you have to provide a security in all your processes, whether it's a IT system, power system, oil and gas, refinery, any system. I need to put a particular kind of security mechanism and processes and monitoring systems. That gives the idea of putting ISO 27001 standard or all these things. So, is it a part of the power system? Of course, lot of ITs are part of the power system. Beside this, we have different processes that its power system has inherently built. So we can map those kind of systems and map to the power system, and then probably you can define your own ISMS practices for this. So that's why it is always that they have defined this in such a way that can be taken care. But as I agree with what Sudarshan told, that is a factor, that whenever we'll see the power system protocols, there are lot of protocols are completely different. And telecom systems, the protocols are completely different. So is there any specialized course are offering by our institutes? So that need to be seen when actually we further find out this. But I am pretty sure that those who are operating in the on-field, we provide them a lot of trainings to them. We expect that they should not know all these protocols, to be very honest. So what we do, we hire those kind of engineers and put them for 1 month extensive training for understanding all these protocols, whether it's a power system, telecom system, and all these things. Because normally, as he rightly pointed out, they understand this TCP/IP, then TLS, SSL, all these 4 or 5 protocols. Then we segregate them. Okay, guys, you know this. These are the environment where you are going to work. These are the protocols. These are the monitoring system we are going to use. So we provide extensive training. We have a training process, and that training team is completely different. They only train those kind of field engineers, those who will go to the field and hands-on. It is not that theoretical training.
we provide the systems, they will be hands-on and monitor all these systems, and that gives them confidence to go to the field and touch the network.
Last question, please.
This is Amit Verma. I am from SSP, and my disclaimer is I am an end user. My specific question is, what is the responsibility and ownership of service providers and vendors? We have got cases where antiviruses have blown up whole networks. We have got cases where a firewall UTM boxes recently have started asking for ID authentications. We have got cases where Microsoft have pushed in patches which have blown up things. So what is the ownership where because see, as an end user, the ownership has to lie somewhere.
I can take if somebody else
sure.
is not taking. Okay, this was today you are the end user, but when you talk about SCADA system, typically it is the end user is some operator. Okay. So today all the operators have to comply with, most of the time it is NetSIP, for example. So there is a regulatory compliance that is mandated, and any supplier, be it antivirus or everything, has to comply. They have to sign off on the dotted line, says I am complying. In which case the liability gets directly to the antivirus guys. So that is where several times, you know, the IT folks trying to enter saying that I have a solution, find it hard. Suddenly the language doesn't match and the compliance requirements are different. So now I see a lot of bridge happening, consortiums happening, people are talking to each other. So essentially it is the operator, because he is on field running it day to day, he is responsible for the compliance. But as solution providers, not necessarily the SCADA system or DCA system guys, but anyone who is providing solution has to comply with that. They are signing on the dotted lines. If they don't know it, then it is to their peril. If they know it, it is a good thing, because you know there is a understanding, there is a mutual recognition of what is needed. The benefit of this regulatory compliance is also that these people who are currently very good in the IT system sector are becoming slowly into ICS cert and NERC-SIP standards committee is trying to understand, trying to influence, can you bring some best practices here and can we learn something from here and take it back to the other part, and so that there can be an integrated system which can take care of both. It is happening.
Sir, it's a very good question, sir. Why I take it, when the Chennai flood happened, a lot of networks are down and all these things. We set up a special task force. 50 engineers, immediately we ship them on road to there. We do not think whether it's operator responsibility, government responsibility, any responsibility. We told it is our responsibility. Guys, go ahead and do these things. So this is actually the need of the hour. We find that if there is something is going to happen to our equipments, we take first responsibility, we take to us. Then we, after maybe solving the problem, this is our philosophy of the company. You take the responsibility first and solve the problem. Later you think to whom we can talk, whether they are responsibility or not. That is what I want to add.
No, see, my point was, because when this whole, I would not like to name that antivirus 3 years back. The first line what I got to hear from my management team was, "Arey to raksha ki bakshal bani."
That's true. See, sometimes it's a configuration also matters. Someone who is capable of configuring that in the right way, in that context, matters.
No. It was the product which had launched a signature, which actually blew up the whole system. In this specific case, where the firewall UTM device is asking for ID authentication, I have analyzed it. Unfortunately, I don't
know. Probably this is too specific a case.
Yeah.
However, the scenario is, it is the boundary stops at where the industrial control system stops and the boundary starts where the IT takes over. This is where he was mentioning about IT-OT integration. There will be a small set of devices where they may have to jointly own the IT and the OT team together.
That's what my point.
And it is basically the change management team which forms and manages that part. That is a discipline that needs to be put into the ground level.
Sir, if I understand your question correctly, and since I'm not a product developer, I can take a lighter view of things. if you look at product development and the time to market and the first mover advantage, you want to capture the market as a product developer. So as the joke goes, that if this IT company was developing a car then version 1 would be without breaks and steering wheels. They would come in version 2 and version 3. So you would have to live with a car without a brake and a steering wheel in version 1.
I think his point is more in terms of, for example, I mean, the IT in most cases.
I think the question is about buggy software.
No.
What is the liability of the software provider?
No, what's not liability? Because the risk, the point is, I have spent that money because that particular service provider or that particular vendor had shown that particular reputation. Okay? And I am putting myself and my network at risk. Because why would you not go to we also not everyone also, we can harden our Linux, we can create a firewall. Everybody knows it. The product which I am talking about, which was I asking for ID authentication, the bug was not with the particular product. The bug was in the design of the product itself because it was using Squid. Squid goes to Chrome and asks for ID authentication, but in this case, when Chrome upgraded the provider, the service provider, the product manufacturer didn't went back and actually did their due diligence. So can you imagine, for a normal user, if Chrome is asking for ID authentication, I am 100% sure 10% of the user must have put in their ID authentication just because they want to surf the net. Just because you want to be connected on the Facebook, you want to be on the Twitter, you would not bother to even think of security as end user. I can definitely challenge that.
See, that kind of challenges are there because of that's what we talked about. The overall situation is like the security, IT products are coming and becoming trying to offer a solution in the OT world, and OT products are trying to do something in the IT world. So this is a sort of mismatch, and there will be, I think, since we have taken the first step, we'll be like the guinea pigs, and we'll go through this. I think the industry, we are not alone in this. There are many people like this are suffering like this, and we'll go through it. It's a passing phase.
Yeah,
trust me on this.
Yeah, just to add on to it, life goes on. We have exactly same thing happened when our mobile and computing world become integrated. Today, every mobile provider, in a way, is a complete compute solution provider because your mobile is a computer in a way. And every compute solution provider is a kind of supporting all the mobiles. So that integration, we went through a lot of challenges and it has happened, and it has happened much faster. The other one which is taking much longer is IPv4 and V6. Still, we are transitioning, and we will continue to be transitioning, I don't know how many decades. Who will really see complete transition, we do not know. Here exactly, this is another same convergence chain is happening. This convergence is going to cause something good and some side effects. Friction will always be there when two things interact, and we will work it out. Definitely, we will work it out. If you want it, slightly different, totally research-oriented approach, because I do manage the research, I have that kind of little bit mindset. He already warned, unfortunately PhD speak weird. Let us look at it this way. Today, protocols are defined. A protocol is nothing but a bit sequence, other than the payload, everything is known. Technically speaking, software engineering offers a solution by which I can do a formal model of it in a pure mathematical abstract model, and then I can use a complete auto code generation, which will exactly comply with what the standard wants. Unfortunately, we do not have a single protocol developer who generates codes like this, because that needs extremely high amount of capable few guys. The day you release the standard, click of a button, the implemented version is ready, which is fully tested. Unfortunately, what we do, standard is developed, every company, protocol company, puts in a bunch of engineers, developers to do it, and then there is a test team that is generated, and then it is somebody does in C, Python, C Sharp, C++, Java, and whatnot. So that many variants get developed, and so the moment a requirement is converted into a software specification and then implemented and tested, there is that many layers of gap. So what is the requirement versus what is implemented? Functionally it may cover, but does it cover, is it a perfect box? It is not. So either it is covering a little bit more or it is covering a little bit less. So there are technical solutions, but our current approach methodology has to drastically change. It will be a game changer, because suddenly all the current application developers or protocol writers, they will be out of job. Suddenly somebody from Mathematical Institute Chennai and things like that, bearded guy, not sleeping, just generating protocol after protocol in a by click of a button.
So that is what is going to, that is the kind of productivity improvement will come, quality improvement will come. I foresee it 10 years down the line because of business and other considerations, but that will probably solve pretty much a lot of problems we are talking about today. We'll be forced to take that route.
Okay, just to summarize, well, not long ago, this the physical world and the cyber world were probably two planets. Hello? They were two planets. They became two worlds. Now they became air-gapped. Now they became fitting into one mobile where you get enterprise dashboard and also the operational dashboard onto one single mobile. So it's not too far. I mean, it's already there, right? And the cyber-physical systems are now started to harm people. And probably there is a one prediction. In 2016, the first murder is going to happen over cyber-physical system. There is a prediction. Let's see how it... But he's talking about an incident already happened in 2014 in Germany, but it's okay. And we also dealt with the power systems, and the industrial control systems have a long life cycle, and IT systems have a shorter life cycle. So there's a challenges, and that also offers up challenges in terms of the skill and availability of resources. And we also talked about the simulation as a means to deal with uncertainty in the system. It's a new method of adopting and understanding cybersecurity in that. Other part we talked about is a 360 degree view of the risk, and there is a whole lot of opportunities in this field. And also there is a tremendous amount of development happening from the developers as well as from the policy makers and from the operators. And the product development is certainly maturing. By the discussion, we got some insights into how the kind of specialized tools they're using, and also the assurance is increasing with respect to product disclosures and responsible disclosures. That's a good news. And this is probably the first session where we didn't talk about identity management, SIEM, DLP, and traditional security products. That's really good. Thank you.
So I'd really like to thank the esteemed panelists and the audience to be very interactive and a patient listener. So thank you, all of you.